Morning, everybody. Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I'm Mark Pringle. My address is 90 El Camino Real, Burlingame. I'm going to take you through a brief slideshow. It should last about 20 minutes or so, but I think it will be important to point out the major issues everybody should be aware of regarding this project. I've been building houses for about 20 years, I guess a little over 20 years now. Mostly in the Bay Area, but since then have been slowly expanding eastward. Finished a project recently in Brentwood, and now we're here in Valley Springs.
There you go. Okay, we'll turn the lights out.
So this is an aerial photo of the area in general. The little red circle is, shows where the site is. To the left of that is Rancho Calaveras. To the right, in green, you can see Rockies. This is a close-up aerial photo. The site is bounded with a red line. Our surrounding uses, we have a Head Start school to the southeast, commercial office and dentist's office to the south, residential and Percocet to the west, rural residential on the west and north side. You can see the golf driving range there in light green on the right. Park intended is on the far right. I wanted to point out Percocet is that white line that comes up from the bottom and makes a little curve to the right and connects it with the north side. Generally, what we're proposing and what we're showing you today is a project with 156 lots with two different neighborhood types. Total site area is 33.5 acres. It is currently zoned R3 mobile home park and commercial. Overall, the lot size is 7,082 square feet. This is an infill location. All impacts of this project have been mitigated. We have an agreement with CCWD to provide water and sewer service. And I think it's important to point out that this is an infill project. I imagine the projects that you see here often are on the outskirts of civilization, perhaps, and out in more forested or more open space areas. This project is different than that in that it is surrounded by commercial and residential uses. I'd like to point out, and I think it's worth noting, what is allowed under the current zoning. Under R3 PD, 12 units per acre, we are allowed to put in 252 units. We're also allowed to put in 75 mobile home units. That would allow us 327 units on this site. Under the current ordinance, there is no tree preservation required. No open space required, no affordable housing required, and there's no approval process required to go through that to put high density residential on the site. Floyd Norrie is the owner of this property. He's here today. He received approval for commercial on the proposed site. He then requested a change of zoning to R3. It was not designated R3 by the county, is not in the general plan as R3, and is also not listed in the county's housing element as part of the R3 inventory. I think it's important to note that, because that's an issue that's been floating around quite a bit. It was Floyd's idea to make it R3 in the first place, and now it's our request, along with Floyd's request, that the zoning change to R1, and I think that that's a more appropriate use for the site. What we are proposing is 156 units, 108 units of standard lots. I call standard lots about 6,000-7,000 square foot lots and 48 cluster lots. We are, under current zoning, allowed to do 7,000 square foot lots. But in our preliminary discussions with the planning department, they recommended that we apply for R1. And the reason for that is that it provides us more flexibility. It provides us the flexibility to do smaller lots than 7,000 square feet, which we feel is important to be in this location. So if we met current zoning, we would have a site with 7,000 square foot lots. It would pretty much look the same, but it would not have any of the smaller lots that we think are valuable. I'm building 38 houses next door to this site. Many of you may have seen it. We've completed the grading on the site work as we go up Highway 26. You may have seen that. Our site work is done, and we're waiting for things to pick up a little bit in the housing market. We'll be right back at it again. So I've been involved in the area for about 2 years now. I enjoy it very much. And so as I was involved in that first 38 units, Floyd and I discussed what was going on with the rest of this property. We discussed its high density zoning and felt that it was inappropriate for high density. So we went to the planning department to discuss that with them. So we put in two areas of cluster housing. You can see those circled in red. So when we started our discussions with the planning staff, it was suggested by the staff that we provide some lower cost housing. And we have done that in those two areas. But we're providing lower cost housing by design, not by mandate, not by restriction. But we have done some at the staff's request, and that is to provide five low income housing units that will be located in that cluster housing area. And those units will sell for an average of $200,000 each. In this plan, we have a progression of unit types. In the lower right is existing commercial, then we transition to high density detached, then we transition in the upper left to our standard lots, and then those are surrounded by rural residential, which are tenant lots. So I think logically, it's a logical progression. We have 48 cluster lots. Minimum lot size is 47 feet by 60. The lot sizes range from 2,800 square feet to 7,700 square feet, and average about 3,600 square feet. The houses on those cluster lots will be from 982 square feet to a little over 2,000. We provide 56 guest parking spaces. The driveways that serve those clusters of four or six houses have no parking allowed in them and no sidewalks. So we have accommodated for that by having 56 guest parking spaces on the street. And this plan, this cluster layout has been approved both by the Public Works Department and by the Fire Department. This is a detail of that cluster. So you can see the driveways in white. The houses are in beige. Each house has a two-car garage and a tiny backyard or side yard of some kind. This is how a cluster is laid out. You can see two-car garages in the stack. There are no one-story houses shown on this, but our 982 square foot houses are one story. Let's move on to the issues that have been of general importance on this project. We'll talk about open source tree farming, storm drainage, grading, tree preservation, biology, and traffic signal. My philosophy, just to give you a little bit of information, is not to provide the planning staff with minimal information and piecemeal information. I don't think that makes any sense, and that's not the way I like to do things. So when we started this thing, we amassed all the information that we thought was necessary and provided to the planning staff all in the beginning. We've analyzed every aspect of this project. This is a plan that's on the pulse on the wall. We went to the Planning Commission in December 2006 and again in June of this year. And during that 6 months, we met with the concerned groups concerned about this project three times. We met with MyValleySprings.com, CSER, Tom and Cusino was also there. And I think the meetings were productive. We listened to the concerns of the groups that were there, and then we went back to the drawing board to address those concerns. So during this process of those discussions, we had already analyzed this project in a very detailed way. But we went back, we took the whole thing apart, and looked at every one of those aspects that were a concern. Made sure that we were doing it as best we could, and then put the project back together again. I think that they should be satisfied with this project. They didn't get all the things that they wanted, and neither did I. But that's the nature of these discussions. I think we tried really hard to make this project the best that we could. Let's talk about open space. We have 4.3 acres of on-site open space, which is 13% of the site. We also have off-site open space, and I think it's worth noting when Floyd originally got the 75-acre project, which includes this site and his commercial approved, he set aside 7.2 acres of open space. And I think that we should get some credit for that as well. How much, I don't know. But if you look at that plus the open space that we're providing on our on this particular site, that totals 15% of the site, and that contains the most valuable areas biologically, which is overlooking the creek area and some large streets. One area that we are setting aside as open space is the upper left-hand corner, which is a detention basin area, and also the creek corridor. We are relocating part of that creek, and we're doing that with the Corps of Engineers oversight. This is a plan from our landscape architect showing what the creek corridor will look like when it's done. We're going to landscape it quite a bit. It's currently a dry creek channel. It's about a foot deep and about a foot and a half wide. But it's important to the safe, and so we're going to do that. And so we'll enhance that creek corridor by planting cedar trees and shrubs. And I think from a biological point of view, the creek corridor will be in a condition that is better than its current state. The second area of open space is for the oak woodland. I think that that oak woodland area biologically is the most valuable area on the site, even though it really hasn't gotten much attention because it doesn't have any large trees. In addition, in the upper right is a community park that will be in the center of the project. And we'll have a walking path and some benches and a children's hot lot. That's a landscape art that bring out. We'll have benches and tables under the tree canopy, and that part will be about a half an acre. Another open space that I've already mentioned is this 7.2 acres. And you can see that. This is the plan of Floyd's overall 75 acres. You can see that light green area. 7 acres in the middle of the project. Let's talk about storm drainage for a minute. Our plan meets the upcoming storm drainage standards. I know that the county is working on those new standards, and this project will meet those. We have water that flows both the Cosgrove and Union Creek. We will have no additional inflows from anywhere on the site. And we have three detention basins that do that. This shows the drainage basins, the Cosgrove Creek drainage areas on the right of the site, and the Eagle Creek drainage area is on the left. We made some storm drainage modifications as a result of our meetings with concerned groups. One of those was to move the detention basin. We moved a detention basin that was actually in the lower right corner up to the upper left corner, and I think it was a great idea, and we enlarged it as well. We also have a detention basin that will catch water that flows into the Oak Woodland area. You can see it. It's a small basin next to lot 7. And we have one off-site detention basin in the open space area. We're expanding an existing wetland area and enhancing it to accommodate an additional flow of stormwater and also to hold water for a longer time during the year. And I think that's valuable to keep water in the wetland area as long as we possibly can. We worked closely with our biologists to design the basin and be sensitive to existing habitat. This produces some notes from our biologists showing where the wetland was. And I just point that out because that's the way we design these things. Is instead of designing it and going to the biologist and say, this works, right? We go to the biologist and say, what should we do based upon what we found? Grading was an issue that was discussed a few times in our meetings. Our grading follows the contours of the site, and our cut and fill does balance on the site. These are some sections a little bit hard to see, but the orange and red show where there are areas of cut and fill. The upper section is a section through the area that goes through the oak woodland and the creek from east to west, and the lower section is a section that goes through the project from north to south. There's not a lot of topographical change over the site. Now, this is a close-up of that upper section, and I point this out because this is the one with the most topographical difference from one to the other. And our maximum cutter fill on the site is about 10 feet. Trees are always an emotional issue. We are preserving 6 of 10 of trees 30 inches or larger. Of the 129 trees that are 6 inches and above on site, we're preserving 77. And in addition to that, we are planting 431 more trees. We worked very closely with Eric, our civil engineer, and our arborist, Harry Bloom, and we analyzed each tree on that site and which ones we could save and which ones we could not. And we have, so we're not guessing as to which trees we're going to save. We know which ones we can save. This is an aerial photo of the site. You can see there's not a lot of trees that we're dealing with on this site. But I think it's still important for us to save some of the trees because there are some beautiful trees and there are some great areas of trees, and we have done that. This is a picture from My Valley Springs. This is tree number 101. It's about a 41-inch diameter tree. We have now located it on its own lot on the west side of the project. This My Valley Springs trespasser is proudly standing next to the tree. And here is another My Valley Springs person standing in front of one of our trees. This is tree number 1. And it will be preserved in the front yard of lot 99. The oak woodland area is on the left in that green circle. And it was designated oak woodland by our registered forester in his report. So that oak woodland area in our open space there is the lower group of trees. And we've expanded that preserve up on that street level. So we are saving all of the oak woodland and some of the surrounding area. Biology, we have studied for the red-legged frog, tiger salamander, and elderberry beetle. Our survey of the site is complete. There is no salamander, frog, or beetle habitat on the site. We've gone as far as we can with our applications. They have been reviewed, and there are no issues by these agencies. This is a plan from our study showing all occurrences for frogs and salamanders within a 5-mile radius of our site, which is a pretty long distance, encompasses all of Hogan Reservoir. There were 6 tiger salamander occurrences within 5 miles, and you can see those in green. And there was one red-legged frog occurrence within 5 miles. There are none within a mile radius of the site. We've worked closely with Army Corps of Engineers, Department of Fish and Game, Regional Water Quality Control Board, and Department of U.S. Fish and Wildlife. Their response has been that they concur with our findings. There is no wetland, no endangered species, or habitat on the site. also did a wetland survey. There is some seasonal wetland, but no wetland in the Corps of Engineers jurisdiction. And finally, a traffic signal. I think everybody knows that we need a traffic signal at the intersection of Vista Del Lago and Highway 26. But we needed to find out how bad it was. So we did a traffic study. We have the data. We know what to do to solve the problem. It can be solved by putting a traffic signal there. Now, our study is complete. And that study also included the traffic from all future projects that we could consider that had been applied for. And at the signal level service now, I think, is F. And after the signal is installed, it will be better. So, to summarize, we are proposing 153 fewer units than the current zoning allows. That's important, I believe, because it provides less impacts on traffic, less impacts on utilities, less contribution to cumulative impacts, which I know is a very sensitive subject for many people in the county. The majority of the trees are preserved on the site. There are no endangered species or wetland. We have water and sewer capacity. Our traffic signal will be installed to solve that issue at the intersection. Storm drain is addressed. I think that this proposed development is the right thing for this site. It's sort of appropriate for the location, as I described. Because we have a variety of housing types, we're also providing affordable housing by design, mostly. And we are also providing 5 homes. They are restricted to an average of $2,000 each. We received Planning Commission approval in December. I'm excited about this project. I spent a lot of time with this project, and I think that it is a beautiful addition to this community. And I hope that you think so as well. So I'm here today to request your approval. We have some consultants here that can answer questions for you. We have John Torrey, who prepared the initial study. John Zentner, our biologist, can answer all questions relating to frogs and trees and stuff like that. John Truxar, our land use attorney, is here. He can help with providing information if necessary on zoning and land use. And Eric, our civil engineer, is here to answer questions upgrading the storm range, and myself.
Thank you. Any further additions by staff at this time? Not any questions from the board before we move to public input?
I just have one clarification. I thought I heard Michael say that part of that was zone C1 on one of his first 2, 3, 4 slides. I didn't see that. Staff doesn't report. Nor did the initial study say that part of the project would be zoned C1. Maybe the projects that seem to be quite competent. So affordable housing can be built. It is possible. During all these all this research and discussion, we were disappointed to find that our zoning code has no protection for R3 zoning, and this is something I hope we can address in the general plan update. It allows a single family subdivision to be built on an R3 parcel as a permitted use with no permit needed or anything. So we're not really sure what the purpose of having an R3 zoning in our housing element is at this point, and how is the county going to be able to provide affordable workforce housing if it continues to let the R3 zoning be converted to single-family subdivisions in the moderate and above price range. We've worked for months to negotiate and find a compromise solution. By the end of the last October meeting, the developer and the CDA made it clear that no multifamily would be built, but we were under the understanding that 10 affordable homes would be built. And we were willing to live with that at that point, but that agreement was withdrawn sometime after the meeting, leaving only 5 moderate affordable homes. And that just to us is not enough for 34 acres of potential for three multifamily housing. So as this project is proposed with only five affordable homes and no multifamily housing on a 34 acre R3 zone site, we do not support this request for the zone change. Thank you.
Thank you.
Resident to Valley Springs. I didn't know I was going to speak today, and when I got here, my wife said I should ask a question, and I promised to ask a truthful question. But after hearing this previous speaker, I had more than a question. I'd like to introduce some common sense into this, if that's okay. I don't understand where the huge workforce, or why the huge workforce would be moving into Valley Springs. The only construction I see going on presently is a new Taco Bell. I oppose high density housing.
The housing element, as was recognized by the speaker. The fact is that we cannot compel developers to build condos or townhouses or apartments in their projects. What we do is we take their project applications and try to make them the best that we can be, given the zoning and the general plan that's in place. We have done that on this project. It does not look the same as it was when it came in. Planning did get involved in this project to try to enhance it. But the fact is, in this particular county, those who have come forward and attempted to build affordable housing, multifamily housing, have had numerous obstacles put up for them at times litigation, and there is a limit of people that are in-house in this county right now that are willing to do apartments. We just lost our last apartment that had been permitted because of the inability for that person to negotiate with Caltrans satisfactorily to make the project worthwhile. So it's a long-term issue to address the disappearing R3 property within the county, or the inability for the county to get multifamily housing in. We do not feel it should be on the back of this particular project to solve that problem.
Thank you.
And the technical details of that will be handled by Mr. Sanders.